All right, so just a quick agenda on what we're going to talk about today. I'm going to start with a brief introduction of the Morpheus project, what that is and why NASA is developing that, and then get into some of the ways we had used atoms to help us in our development process for that vehicle. You'll get to see some footage of our tests with this vehicle. One of the videos you'll see is from an earlier tether test. That's where we attach the vehicle to a crane and do some small motion with the engine lit. And later you'll see some free flight footage, which is completely untethered flight of that vehicle. So along with that, there will be a brief explanation of the procedure of implementing that telemetry playback functionality in atoms. Along with a little bit of theory on how you get that telemetry file to be read in a dynamic analysis such that the atom solver can interpret that well. And there will be a little bit more Morpheus information at the end, and if we have time, I'll get into a little bit to the procedure of actually using a subroutine for that motion constraint in the atoms model. So, Morpheus basically is a prototype lander vehicle that NASA has been developing, and the purpose of that is to develop new kinds of landing technology. So the vehicle itself is a terrestrial vehicle. It's not designed to be used in space, but it allows us to increase the fidelity and the readiness of technologies that eventually will be used in space. Where atoms comes into play is atoms can be used to take raw telemetry data from the vehicle over the course of a given flight or a given test, and then use that data as an input to a general motion constraint in the atoms model, which will then, over the course of the simulation, basically replay the motion of the vehicle during the flight in that simulation. So what that allows us, it allows us to really take a close look at the flight trajectory over the course of a test. It allows us to look at the vehicle from any angle, so we're not limited by, camera placement and our keep-out zones for personnel, and we could play it back at any speed. So this allows us to really check out the trajectory for anomalies in our control system and that kind of thing. So also in the simulation, you'll see a 3D model of an artificial hazard field. So the purpose of that is that's something that's actually in place during each of our tests. We built an artificial hazard field to simulate the terrain of either the moon or Mars or any intended landing point that includes some like craters and boulders. And one of the technologies that we're testing with a vehicle is autonomous landing and hazard avoidance. So there's hardware aboard the vehicle that will scan the terrain and direct the vehicle to land in a place that's safe and devoid of those craters and boulders. All right, so the next slide you'll see a side-by-side play of actual footage of our tether test along with the atom simulation of the tether test right below it. Then after that, you'll see the same thing for a free flight test. And then one of the other videos we'll show is footage from an angle that we can't get with the camera because we're limited in our how close we can get and what kind of angles we can get. And also it'll be at an increased playback speed. So basically so far what we've done, the footage that you'll see is some of our earlier tests. But lately, within the past couple months or so, we've really been pushing the limits of some of these trajectories and flying higher and further. And actually, you can look up any of our flights in YouTube videos. Just look up Morpheus Free Flight 10, for example, and you'll get to see some of the raw footage of some of our tests. So without further ado, here's that tether test. So as you can see, we suspend the vehicle underneath the crane and light the engine and have it go through its intended flight trajectory. Obviously, we're limited to what kind of trajectories we can do while we're suspended by the crane, but this just kind of shows how Even though the motion is somewhat limited, we're still taking telemetry data, which we are then able to play back in the atom simulation, which you see on the bottom there. And so I guess I should explain that the tether test is kind of an intermediate step over the course of our whole test campaign. So when we built this vehicle, you know, we started out with basically just an engine on a test platform, and we, you know, light it several times and study the vibroacoustics and all that. And then when we think we're ready, we install the engine into the vehicle, chain the vehicle to the ground, and light the engine while the vehicle is chained down, just to study the whole, you know, feed system as a whole. And then the next step were these tether tests, where we would suspend the vehicle and finally get some motion. And that's where the Adams model started to become useful, because we would get motion in our telemetry file that we could then play back. And finally, the last step after we've done the tether test is to do a complete free flight. So what you'll see here is side-by-side playback of footage from one of our free flights, along with the Adams simulation of that. So in the top view, the camera kind of jumps around a bit, so it's not as consistent as the one on the bottom. But as you can see, I tried to synchronize it pretty well. In the top one, it looks like it's just descending vertically, but it's actually moving into the screen. You'll get to see it when they switch views here in a second. There you go. And so on that bottom video, that brown region you kind of see there is our 3D model of the artificial hazard field. So during these earlier flights, the vehicle knew its intended landing point and was directed to fly directly there. But actually, in the next couple of weeks, we'll be doing our first tests where the autonomous landing technology completely takes control of the vehicle and does and directs the flight to its landing point that it picks out with the hazard avoidance technology. All right, and finally, this is that last view. This is an example of something that we can't get really with any of our camera footage, this overhead look, looking down almost the bore site of that the scanning LIDAR, which scans the terrain to look for debris and craters to avoid. And this is played back at twice the speed of the actual test. All right. So, I guess I should explain that. That green structure you see above that orangish spherical tank on the right, that's kind of a gimbal mechanism of that flash LIDAR hardware that scans the terrain and determines the optimal landing location. Okay, so the way we incorporated this into the model is as follows. So the model itself is actually pretty simple. There are, you know, there's only really one moving body, and that is the Morpheus vehicle. The constraint that is applied to it is a general 6 degree of freedom motion constraint. So right now what you see here are three constraints applied to rotation, and there was actually another motion constraint that I used to apply the constraints to the translation degrees of freedom. And the only reason why I did that is because our telemetry data uses a different coordinate system for translation than it does for rotation. If all 6 degrees of freedom use the same coordinate system, then you could just have user 1, user 2, user 3 for translation, user 4, user 5, user 6. So I guess I should explain. So that user function, when it shows up in a motion constraint, basically tells Adams, okay, there's going to be a custom subroutine that I need to look for this constraint. And it's actually called the MOT sub subroutine, M-O-T-S-U-B, and MSC has a lot of good documentation on how to use that. But basically, the number in parentheses gets passed to the subroutine along with a time value and a derivative value. So what the subroutine will do will take that time value and derivative value along with the number in parentheses, which in this case, I just had 1 through 6 for each of the 6 degrees of freedom, but they could be any values you want as long as they're consistent with the subroutine. And the subroutine uses that telemetry data for that degree of freedom to determine where that that body in the analysis should be at that given time. So I'll go in a little bit more explanation here of what that telemetry data consists of and how you get it to show up in the Morpheus, or excuse me, in the Adams analysis. So our telemetry data is just basically time and 6 degrees of freedom position. So we don't have any velocity or acceleration values in the raw telemetry data, and that will require a little bit of post-processing of that telemetry data, which I'll show in a minute. But the important thing to note is that the subroutine can work a single degree of freedom at a time, because the MOTSUB subroutine gets past that integer value from the atom solver to ask, you know, which degree of freedom it's looking for. So over the course of this next explanation, you can consider the data points to be just 1 degree of freedom from this telemetry data. All right, so as you know, Adams is a multi-body dynamic solver, which means that it uses the forces and constraints in the model to determine the motion of those multiple bodies in the simulation. So because it uses forces and mass properties, it requires that not only position be continuous over the course of the analysis, but also velocity and acceleration. So for those to be continuous over the entire time domain, it's important to note that you can't just do linear interpolation between the telemetry data points, because obviously, for example, at time t equals 1 second here on the plot, you have an instantaneous change in velocity. So right before 1 second, it thinks its velocity is positive because it just drew a straight line between that and the previous time step. Then immediately after t equals 1 second, it thinks the velocity is negative because you just drew a straight line between those two time steps. So it kind of breaks the atom solver because it thinks there's an infinite force because there's an instantaneous change in velocity. So the tricky part is then to go from linear interpolation of that telemetry data to fifth order interpolation. So you might ask, you know, why fifth order interpolation? And the answer is a fifth order polynomial has 6 coefficients, ax to the fifth plus bx to the fourth plus cx cubed plus dx squared plus ex plus f. And those 6 coefficients are the minimum number necessary in order to match position, velocity, and acceleration at the 2 data points on either end of the interpolation region, right? Because it's position, velocity, and acceleration that you want to be continuous, which means that those values have to meet at each of those data points. So whatever formula you use in that interpolation region, the values for position, velocity, and acceleration have to match at both data points. And so that's why you need six variables, and there's 6 coefficients to that fifth order polynomial, which is why we use the fifth order. Okay, so in just regular linear interpolation, the slope of the line between the points obviously is just determined by delta y over delta x. And then any time in between that atoms or that you would do during an interpolation uses this formula at the bottom, where x is the time step you're looking for and a is the most recent time step in the telemetry data. So for example, if you're looking for the value at time 0.9 seconds, you would just take the value at 0.8 seconds and that slope times 0.9 minus 0.8. However, for fifth order interpolation, it's basically just an extension of that. And instead of using just the first derivative, you use the second, third, fourth, and fifth derivative. And the equation for the interpolation basically becomes the Taylor series expansion of that fifth order polynomial. And that's that equation you see at the bottom there. So using that, the position and the first through fifth derivatives, you can create a polynomial fit between data points that will be continuous in position, velocity, and acceleration throughout the whole time domain. So the first step in determining those derivatives is to find the first and second derivative at each data point. Now, the easiest way to do that, there are infinite ways of doing it, but the most, the ones that's the easiest way to get data is to just fit a parabola between three consecutive data points. So that red line, that red parabola you see here is just the single unique parabola that hits the first three data points. And so you would take the velocity and you would take the first and second derivative of that parabola at that middle data point and assign that to be the velocity and acceleration at that time step in your telemetry data. And you just do the same thing for each set of three consecutive data points throughout the whole telemetry data file. And for the two end regions, you just use that parabola and extend it to the end points, since you can't, there's no negative time domain data point to hit a value to. Okay, so this is just the matrix math you would do using that Taylor series to determine what those first and second derivatives are. So down there at the bottom, you see it's just first and second derivative, and it's just a multiplication of a 2x2 matrix by a 1x2, or 2x1, excuse me. All right, so the third, fourth, and fifth derivatives that's the next step. After you've determined a velocity and acceleration that you've kind of artificially imposed in your telemetry data file. Because remember, the telemetry data file initially just contained position values at each time step. So now you've come up with these velocity and acceleration values based on the procedure we just talked about. And so now we got to find third, fourth, and fifth derivatives. So you might ask, well, why don't you just do that all at once? Why do you find the first and second derivatives at each data point first, and then go back and find the third, fourth, and fifth? And the reason is the procedure above, where you take a parabola at each time step, has a little bit of anticipation of the next data point built into that algorithm. So if there was none of that, if you just took it a data point at a time for the first through fifth derivatives, what you'd find is that while technically you'd be hitting each data point, you'd start to see these huge oscillations of values in the interpolation regions between the data points. So it's necessary to find the first and second derivatives at each time step using this procedure first in order to keep that polynomial interpolation stable between the data points. Okay, so now that we have the velocity and acceleration at each data point, we just use a similar process with using Taylor series expansion to find the third, fourth, and fifth derivatives. So remember, the goal is just to make position, velocity, and acceleration values match at each data point. So that becomes the next three equations. So you want f of the next time step, to equal the same value for the polynomial fit in the next region at that time step. And you just work out the matrix equations below. And so finally, that gives you a position through fifth derivative for each value at the telemetry file. And so when in the atom subroutine during its initialization step, you load that file into an array, which atoms will use later. So it's basically, if you have 6 degrees of freedom, your array size is however many time steps you have, number of rows, and 37 columns. And that 37 columns is 0th through 5th derivative for each of the 6 degrees of freedom plus the time column. And so when the atom solver basically requests a position at any given time, the subroutine uses that array and finds the most recent time step. For example, if the atom requests time at 1.3, it'll use the values from 1.2 in the array in that equation shown at the bottom. And again, that's just Taylor series expansion from that most recent time step using the first through fifth derivatives. So just to take a look at the results for that, as you can see in that plot, the position versus time chart is smooth and continuously differentiable, as is the velocity versus time plot. However, the acceleration versus time plot, while is continuous, it's not continuously differentiable. So you'll see sudden jumps in the values at the data points. But Adams is okay with that. As long as acceleration is continuous, it doesn't have to be continuously differentiable. So that's the procedure for implementing that. Now I'll just talk a little bit more about kind of what the actual Morpheus project, what our goals are, and how Adams has helped us with that. So the fuel oxidizer mixture that Morpheus uses is kind of a new technology. We use liquid methane, liquid oxygen, and the benefits of that are, you know, we don't have as cold of a storage temperature required for those propellants, which means we can have much more efficient mass capabilities of the spacecraft. Also, one of the big pluses of those is, you know, methane and oxygen, we're developing the technology to get those out of the regolith of whatever our destination is. In other words, we would manufacture the propellants at our destination, whether it be Moon, Mars, asteroid, and that way we don't have to store and take our propellant for the entire trip. But the real technology that we're using with Morpheus that Adams is helpful with is this autonomous landing and hazard avoidance that I talked about earlier. And the benefits of that are you can have a lot wider potential landing zones or less restrictions on your potential landing zones, excuse me, because with limited hazard avoidance technology, our intended landing points for any of our vehicles have to be ones that are pretty clear of craters and obstacles. And so we're somewhat limited in the exploration tasks we can do because our landing zones are restricted to ones that are relatively flat and debris-free. So the autonomous landing and hazard avoidance technology lets us use a lot more potential landing zones for our vehicles. So again, in summary, that's the goal of our Morpheus prototype vehicle. And our flight test data is able to be played back through Adams using those custom MOTSUB subroutines. And in order to do that, you require that first through fifth derivative of each position and each degree of freedom at the time steps in order to have that stable interpolation. So I guess before we go into Q&A, I'll just show a quick view of some of that algorithm. So basically the process is just to take that 37-column array file, write that to a binary file, which then gets gets loaded into your subroutine. So again, MSC provides some pretty good documentation on how to use those custom user subroutines. So this is actually just from some of that installation literature. You can find basically what it's looking for in that MOTSUB subroutine. So the things that get passed to that subroutine are basically this initialization flag, the derivative order, the time value, and that parameters, and that's the number from that parentheses list. So using those values that get passed to the subroutine, you write your subroutine to output a value based on those inputs. So basically all we did here was during that initialization pass, you just read that binary file that contains all your telemetry data. And then depending on your derivative order, you use the appropriate Taylor series expansion to find the value that it's looking for at that time. And that's basically all there is to it. So without further ado, I guess we'll open it up for questions.